What is up, Rhythm Church? It is great to see you guys today. Real quick, before we dive into anything else, I want to say thank you guys. If you were a part of Trunk or Treat in any form or fashion, yes, that guy was a part of it. It was great. We had about 160 people come through, and so a lot of people came through. It was just a blast. If you did a trunk, it was amazing. It was impressive. If you prayed for it, if you told people about it, whatever it was, just thank you guys for doing that. It was a really, really good time. So my name is Corey. I'm the lead pastor here, and we are in a series right now called The Real Jesus, where we are talking about the life of Jesus as we see it through the Gospel of Mark. We've gone through now, hit a handful of different things. And just, again, looking at who Jesus is, what is he like? What is he like for us? What does that mean for our relationship with God? And so it's been great so far. Today we are going to be in Mark chapter 9. So we're going to jump ahead a couple chapters. Then next week we're going to go back a chapter, which is going to bother you really bad if you're OCD. So just forgive me for that in advance. But it's all, there's a method to the madness. So Mark 9. We're going to start at verse 14, and then we're going to work our way down to verse 24. If you have been here since I got here, then you are probably familiar with the fact that I am a fan of monster movies, particularly movies about overly sized animals that wreak havoc on the areas around them. So Godzilla, King Kong, Anaconda, Jaws is my favorite movie of all time. And so this is a strange obsession that started when I was a kid, and it has still lasted up until today. But a piece of that, when I was younger, I had a fascination with myths and legends. I had a fascination with these things that a lot of people would think, well, that's kind of ridiculous, but I put in the work to try to understand it. For instance, one of those would be the Loch Ness Monster. I did a lot of research into the Loch Ness Monster when I was a kid. Unfortunately, this photo is a fake. I found that out. I'm still not convinced that that it's not in there. That's a big lake, okay? Just saying. But I loved this when I was a kid. I would literally go to the library at school and grab books on the Loch Ness Monster, and I would sit there and try to read them because I really wanted to prove that this thing was true. Another one that I was quite obsessed with was Bigfoot, okay? I think my dad's going to be in town next weekend, so if you see anyone that looks like that, don't worry, all right? It's probably just him. It's not Bigfoot. Me and my brother would literally spend hours. We shared a room growing up. We would spend hours watching this show called Finding Bigfoot. Has anyone ever seen that show before? That's all right. If you don't want to raise your hand because you're embarrassed, like, I kind of understand that, all right? Because it was a really interesting show where you had these guys that were extremely smart but also did way too many drugs. And so then they would go out and try to find Bigfoot. And it was, there was like six seasons. And you would think at some point you'd be like, hey, man, I don't think you're going to find him. But they kept trying, and I kept watching, which is why they kept making more seasons. This is another one. Again, I grew up in Texas. Okay, you guys may not be familiar with the El Chupacabra, okay? I don't exactly know what this looks like. I'm just assuming it's something like that. Because people say, well, it looks kind of like a strange dog or coyote, but then other people say, well, actually, it's a monster that's got spikes down its back. So that felt somewhere strangely in the middle. And so, again, I would go onto YouTube before, you know, social media was a thing, and I would watch these videos, right? Because I wanted to prove that these things were real. Because most people doubted the myths, but I believed them, right? I believed that they were out there. Now, granted, as you grow up, you start to believe in these things a little bit less. Maybe not the Loch Ness Monster. Again, I'm still out on that one. But you start to believe a little bit less in these different myths and legends and such. But I've also noticed that as you go through life and you mature and you experience things, both good and bad, it's not just the myths and legends that you start to doubt. Sometimes it's God himself or your relationship with God. Right? When you go through difficult things, sometimes it becomes hard to hold on to those truths that you were so confident of at one time prior to that. And if that's you, and you wrestle with those things, that's okay. Because the guy in our story today wrestled with those same things. So, if you have a Bible, Mark chapter 9, we're going to start at verse 14. Like I said, we're going to go down to verse 24. We're going to skip a couple little ones in there as well to keep the narrative smooth and clean. It starts like this. It says, when they came to the disciples, they saw a large crowd around them and scribes disputing with them. Jesus asked them, what are you arguing with them about? Someone in the crowd answered him, teacher, I brought my son to you. He has a spirit that makes him unable to speak. Whenever it seizes him, it throws him down and he foams at the mouth. He grinds his teeth and he becomes rigid. I asked your disciples to drive it out, but they couldn't. So they brought the boy to Jesus. When the spirit saw him, it immediately threw the boy into convulsions. He fell to the ground and rolled around, foaming at the mouth. So Jesus says, how long has this been happening to him? From childhood, he said. And many times it has thrown him into fire or water to destroy him. So here is the problem that we are seeing. This dad's son is possessed by a dangerous, destructive demon, but the disciples can't drive it out, and the scribes, religious leaders, don't want to drive it out. They have no desire. So there's this weird tension here where you would think maybe one of these two groups, the religious leaders of the day or Jesus' own disciples, if anyone's going to be able to help in this moment, it's probably going to be one of those two groups, and yet both of them have dropped the ball, both of them have blew it. So as they're bickering back and forth, Jesus approaches this dad, and this dad says, hey, these guys aren't doing anything, so I'm going to ask you directly. So he starts explaining to Jesus the problem. He starts explaining what's going on with his son and how difficult this has been. He says, hey, this has been going on since childhood. So this has been a difficult thing, and so far no one's been able to help. So Jesus has a conversation. He strikes it up and says, okay, let's talk about this a little bit. And this dad explains through tears this situation at hand. He explains what is going on, and as he's going back and forth, he finally gets to the end, and he asks this big question, this big, important question. He says, but if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Jesus said to him, if you can, everything is possible for the one who believes. And immediately the father of the boy cried out, I do believe, help my unbelief. This is probably one of my favorite passages in all of the New Testament. I also am aware that I said that one other time, but I said favorites. Okay, you can have multiples. Hey, Bob, you want to turn this down just a smidge? I love this passage because to me, it's one of those passages that I can sort of see myself in. There's some times where I read passages, you know, for instance, if you're not familiar with the New Testament, there's some really interesting things. So you got this passage in the beginning, the early church is starting, you got guys like Peter, who Peter's kind of a big deal. And so literally there was a time where Peter was so filled with the Spirit at the start of the church, he would walk by people and his shadow would heal them. And I read that and I'm like, that's not going to happen for me. It also said that sometimes the sweat on his rag would heal people. I'm like, one, that's gross. Two, still, probably not going to happen to me or anyone I know. So sometimes I look at these stories and go, I can't see myself in there as much. This one, I see this guy and his struggle, this internal tension he's experiencing, and I'm like, hey, that sounds familiar. The things that this guy is dealing with, I understand because I have dealt with the same thing. Because again, think about it. This struggle, this suffering has been going on for a long time. And so naturally, this dad He's not really sure what's going to help at this point. He's not sure. I mean, his best bet after those two groups of people that are arguing is this Jesus guy. Right? Jesus has been known to be healing people, and some people say he's the Messiah. And so for him, he's going, well, I'm just going to throw it out there. I'm going to see if this guy can do anything. And I love his phrase because you can hear the tremble in his voice. You can hear the doubt where he says, I believe, but help my unbelief. He's saying, I believe, but I'm also struggling to believe. And it sounds kind of like a contradiction at first. Because think about it. He's saying, I have belief, but I don't have belief. So it sounds like he's contradicting himself, but again, if you think about your own life and your own experiences, I think that this guy is voicing the regular Christian experience. In fact, I would say it like this, the tension that he's voicing is that there is a gap between his knowledge of God and his trust in God. So for us, the tension we experience is that there's a gap between our knowledge of God, what goes on up here, and yet our trust in God, what goes on in here. We know things, but we don't always believe things. We're aware of things, but we don't always live as if those things are true. That's what he's voicing here. Again, he's like, I've heard the stories. I know about this Jesus guy. And up here, I know he can do this, but in here, I don't know if he's going to. I don't know that I trust him to do this. And again, I would imagine that we've all been there to some degree. Maybe you had a great plan for your life. You had this dream and you had it all mapped out and then it came crumbling down. And you thought, well, man, I really believed that God was going to do that, but now he didn't. And so I'm wrestling with God's goodness towards me. Maybe you had a marriage that was promising and you were excited about the future and then your spouse was unfaithful and you thought, well, this is not what I had as a part of my plan. And why would God allow this? We all have those things that we know are true, but we struggle to believe that they're true because of the things that we experience. And so if you are in that spot, that's okay, because Jesus can handle those things. In fact, like I said, I think this is a part of our regular experience of life. There's a word in the Bible, we don't necessarily use it a lot in regular language, but it's a word called sanctification. And sanctification is sort of this process of becoming more like Jesus over time, of God changing us. And I think one part of it is I think that sanctification is the process of belief moving from our head to our heart. That is essentially how change works. We come to know something, but over time, God's Spirit helps us believe it and experience it, and then we begin to live it. So all of our lives, from now until the very end, we will be going through this process of God helping us trust in our hearts what we know in our heads. It's a continual process. And it can be frustrating, right? We've talked about this a few weeks ago, that it can be slow. It can feel like your growth is slow and is not happening on your time or your terms. But it will happen. Now, the thing I love about this story is one, he lays out his doubts in front of Jesus, just puts them all out there. But I love not only what he did, but I love what he didn't do. Because whenever we are wrestling with doubts and wrestling with the tension between what we know and what we trust, we have a tendency to do one of two things. And this guy did neither of those. See, the first thing is he didn't fake it. And I love that. He didn't fake it before Jesus. You know, he didn't say, "Hey, Jesus, I'm doing great, man. I am blessed and highly favored. You are mighty to save. Can you take care of this? Because I believe." He didn't try to fake it. He didn't try to act like everything was okay. He was just honest 100% about where he was at. He didn't fake it. The other day, Kara and I, we rewatched Man of Steel, which is a Superman movie, fantastic movie, by the way. And there's this funny scene where they have Superman in a holding cell or an interrogation room. And naturally, like in all the movies, you know, this room has the one window. And if you're inside, it's a mirror. But if you're on the other side, it's a window where you can see what's going on over there. And so Superman is sitting down and he's talking to Lois Lane, his soon-to-be love life person. And this psychologist on the other side of the wall kind of pipes in on the microphone and he starts to tell Superman his name, and Superman looks at the blank wall and he goes, "Oh," and he finishes his name for him. He goes, "No, I can see you. Yeah, I can see your name badge right there. I can also see a half-eaten roll of Altoids in your pocket as well. And I can see the military people behind you that are ready to use a taser on me if needed." It's not needed. But it's funny because they're trying to hide behind this wall, and they forget that superheroes sometimes have X-ray vision. So the wall is not going to do anything. He's saying, "I can literally see everything going on in there, even though you've put this wall between us." And sometimes I feel like that's what it's like when we try to fake it before God. We're like, "Oh, God, I'm good." And he's like, "Actually, you're not. Because I can see what's going on." Maybe able to fake a lot of people out. But I can see the doubts. I can see the fear. I can see the struggle. I can see the anxiety. I can see all of those things. So you don't have to fake it anymore. God sees it all. So this guy didn't fake it. But another thing that I love is that not only did he not fake it, but he also didn't fix it. He also didn't just straight away get to work on all the things that he could do. In fact, up until this point, that's all he's done. He's run around town trying to fix it to get people to help. And in this moment, he's not doing that. Because he realizes, "Hey, I'm at the end of my rope." So he doesn't say, "Hey, Jesus, I pretty much got this, man. But if you could hold my tools, I would like to fix this myself." No, he didn't do that. He laid it before Jesus and said, "Hey, I've been trying to fix this, and I can't do it. So if you could go ahead and take this and handle this, that would be the best solution." He says, "Look, Jesus, I think you can do this, but I have some doubts. I think you're able, but I'm having trouble trusting that. And so here you go. I'm going to throw it out there and hope for the best." And if you're in this situation, if you're anything like me, my thought is, if I'm that honest with God, the God of the universe who created all things, if I'm that honest with God, his response is going to be negative. He's going to be angry with me. He's going to be frustrated with me. He's going to be irritated with me. He's going to be disappointed in me. That's how I would expect him to respond. And I don't know what this guy expected, but if it was something like that, he was expecting the wrong thing. If you pick up in verse 25, the very end part of this, says, "When Jesus saw that a crowd was quickly gathering, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, 'You mute and deaf spirit, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again.' And then it came out shrieking and throwing him into terrible convulsions, and the boy became like a corpse, so that many said, 'He's dead.' But Jesus, taking him by the hand, raised him and stood him up." So after this ugly, honest confession where he just puts it all out there, Jesus does rebuke someone. There is a rebuke that happens, but it is not to this dad. It is not to the doubting person. It is to the destructive demon. So if we're expecting Jesus to rebuke us, to put us in our place when we come to him with our honest struggles, we're wrong. That's not what's going to happen. Jesus is going to take us with all of our mess. He's going to scoop us up, and he's going to rebuke the things that are destroying us, not us ourselves, which is great because that means that you don't have to fake it or fix it for Jesus. You don't got to fake it or fix it for Jesus. You don't have to come in every Sunday, which, again, I know that all of us to an extent wear a mask, even the best of us. But we don't have to come in Sunday with this pretense of everything's okay. I'm doing great. Everything's awesome. Nothing has gone wrong this week. I'm not struggling with anything. Right? Sometimes the mentality in church is that, you know, when you come in, it's like everyone's okay until they say they're not. Sometimes it's the opposite. Sometimes we come in here and we're all a mess. And we're just trying to act like everything's cool. It's okay to not be okay. But Jesus is so good that he doesn't want you to stay that way. So we can come with all of our struggles and our doubts and all those things. We don't got to fake it. We don't got to try to fix it ourselves. Jesus will love us. And sometimes he does that even through his church. So sometimes when we are hiding the things that we're wrestling with, we are depriving Jesus of using his people to help us. Maybe someone wants to pray for you. Maybe someone has an answer to a prayer that you've been asking for. Sometimes Jesus wants to use his people. And so if we come in honest and open, that's where the church can rally and say, how can we love this person? How can we encourage you? How can we just sit with you and be there as you're dealing with these things? Jesus is so good. The real Jesus is so kind, is so gentle, is so patient with us in our struggles, in our sins, in our doubts. He is so good, and he is willing and able to help us if we'll just come to him and lay it all out before him. And that's why at the end of services, I usually ask if anyone needs prayer, and I'll go stand in the back, and you can come pray. It's not that my prayers are better than anyone else. But the reason we do that is because, again, we're trying to create that culture where it says, hey, it's okay to come and admit you've got some stuff going on. You need some people praying for you. And so we'll do that today as well. And I hope that if you're wrestling with some stuff that you can either come ask for prayer or you can grab one of our prayer request slips and drop it in the box because we'd love to pray for you as you're navigating the difficult things of life and faith sometimes. But know that as you're doing that, Jesus is faithful, he is good, he cares, he is compassionate, he is not going to rebuke you, he is going to help change you by his grace, by his mercy, by his love over time. Let's pray together. God, we do thank you for your grace, God, for your kindness. Lord, in all of our sin, in all of our mess, God, you have every right to rebuke us, to push us away when we come to you. But God, you are so good and you are so great that you just accept us as we are and you pick up all the pieces we've left behind and you create something beautiful out of it. And God, we just thank you so much for that. God, we thank you for your mercy, for your grace. God, I pray for anyone in here who is struggling. God, maybe they have some unbelief that they are dealing with, some doubts that they are wrestling with, some things that they are trying desperately to get to move from their heads to their hearts. God, I pray that you would be gracious to them. God, that you would comfort them, that you would care for them, God, that you would change them. We love you, Lord. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.